So there's a few things we want to speed through before we start just talking and Chevy does weird stuff that we make fun of. We're very excited about the DVD that is dropping on the 21st. And we want you to buy it real bad because that's how you get caught up so you can watch the second season start on the 23rd. September. I should specify September, shouldn't I? What are we, weird astrologically based monk culture? There's 12 months. September is the one I'm talking about. And the DVD, we have put a lot of love into, and we really want you to have it, so I believe you'll be receiving at this Q&A panel special Greendale Community College badges. Woo! But there's more. Those badges have a coupon on them that will give you $5 off our DVD.
Yeah.
The DVD, we did everything we could as a first season DVD. I'm from a generation that the DVD represents the top. Of, like, some of you are into the more BitTorrent total theft. Still flattering, but. DVDs is the most important thing. It's the thing you hold. It's the last thing you have on your deathbed. Maybe your loved ones are there too. But so we put extra stuff into it with the fan in mind. And one of the most exciting things, particularly for this demographic, I would think, is an original Kick Puncher comic book. It punches a power of kicks, and it was drawn by Jim Mahfood, who I've had a relationship with, a creative relationship with, going back to the days of Fireman Press and Scott the Disposable Assassin, which is why I was here at Comic-Con in the 90s, and I can't believe what's happened to this place, but that's a good thing. But Jim Mahfood is like from back then, and it's cool that he, was able to partner with us again and do this awesome comic book, which was actually written by Troy Barnes, who is Donald's character. There's all kinds of video goodies on the DVD as well, which brings us to, I think we're going to give you a little sneak peek of one of the bonus things on the DVD.
Start with you, Joel.
Because there's nothing better on. And this.
Witty banter. Betty White? Woo!
Wow.
That's really
disgusting
to pick up. What did you?
Troy, I'm in love triangle.
Dan Harmon is really funny.
Amazing comedic ensemble and tags.
Because we love you lots.
Now, my favorite episode last season was an episode called... Oh, I'm sorry, Dan. I forgot you down there.
Episode 4, Apollo 13 homage.
Yes!
Now, go ahead. My favorite episode last season was Modern Warfare, and I swear. I was going to ask if you could top that, but with an Apollo 13 homage, you're clearly already on your way there, so I won't ask that. Where did that idea come from? Why don't we start with you, Dan, and some of the other producers can chime in.
Sorry.
Where did you guys get the idea to do an action episode of a comedy?
I only heard the word passion. Okay, I didn't hear the word passion. I heard the word action. Where did I think about that? Where did I get the idea? Wow, this hour's gonna go fast. Where did we get the idea? Easy. I think this whole generation kind of like we like movies more than TV because TV sort of kind of became something that we felt jaded about, and so we. During the 90s, we kind of like got really into movies. I don't know. My favorite movie is Die Hard, and I just like kind of popcorn, visceral stuff. But I also love television, and I love working in it. And so I wanted to get to my strong corner fast in the first season before we got canceled.
It's a very flexible premise. Community. We're just trying to see what we can do.
To be a Bruce Willis type action. I would have bid on it just to because it was the most fun I've ever had doing anything ever, and that's including drugs. No. It was, and Justin Lin, the director, has to be given a ton of credit because that guy. The NBC executives were trying to burn down the studio, our sets, because it was costing so much money. Because it took us about 8 days to shoot it, I think. 8 full days for 23 minutes of footage.
We usually shoot in 5 days. Continue.
We've never shot in 5 days.
Pretend that we shoot in 5 days. I'm just laying the ground for you guys.
I pulled a muscle in my back. Donald had all his teeth replaced. These are all fake teeth. And Danny was broken in half. Yeah. And
thankfully, I like Gumby. I'm flexible, so I can get put back in place.
Danny's like Gumby.
And when Ken Jeong came on in the white suit as Chow Yun Fat. That's why I'm so glad Ken is here today. Ken?
Ken.
Oh, crap.
Danny and Donald, when did you know that you were in TV's greatest bromance? And I hate to use that term.
Thanks, you guys. I don't know. I guess
either.
When I first met Danny, he
was naked.
He helped me move. Like, he didn't know me at all. And he was like, yo, Ken, I was like, I'll move this weekend. And he was like, oh, I'll help you. And then it was just like us in short shorts and visors.
In downtown LA alleys.
Alleys.
Everyone's like, what are those guys in short shorts?
You have to
have the guys in an alley in downtown LA? They must be up to trouble. We're just moving boxes.
But I think it's just like, we just get along pretty well. I don't know.
Donald's a comedic genius. He's the writer for 30 Rock. Makes it real easy, but it's fun when we get to do kind of fun little bits and rap, and people are like,
yeah.
Yeah!
No? Okay.
Can I answer the question? moving boxes and rapping.
Then there was the episode with insects.
Chevy, you are a comedy legend. Why did you do that? What about this show made you decide it would be your show to return to TV with?
This is what I heard. Where is the show? I don't remember any words. Sending up our name. These kids needed a lesson. I thought that the first script was really good, and I never thought I'd end up doing a show like this. But I said yes, clearly way too early. And, now I love it because I love my castmates. And I love the respect I get from them. Anyway, I like to make people laugh. and that's why I'm there, doing it. And what was the question? You know, quite seriously, we cannot tell. We can't hear a thing that we're saying up here.
It's true.
So, they're not because of the echo, our speeches.
We have a lot of problems.
Yeah. So, I'll just keep talking.
All right. Allison, after the... I read what the internet has to say. After the episode featuring the debate, the internet went a little crazy for the idea of Jeff and Annie. How did that make you feel?
Oh, well, first let me just say that I love this crowd's enthusiasm. You guys... me, and in the hallway she was like, you kissed Joel in the next episode, FYI. And I was like, ha, ha, ha. Oh, Gillian. I started, I was like, oh, Gillian, you're so funny. I didn't do that, I'm sorry. The story just went awry. I didn't think it was really gonna happen, and then we did it in the episode, and it was supposed to be kind of awkward, but there was this chemistry that developed, and the fans really took to it, and it was really interesting to read, like fan fiction online about Annie and Jeff having sex. Put me to bed some nights. No, okay. But it was exciting. It was an exciting turn of events for Annie and for myself. Thank you.
What's your favorite site for community fan fiction?
Joe Russo? You email them to me.
I don't
know that stuff. Oh, I know. It's like, fuck yeah, Jeff Annie.
Yeah.
Some sort of list if you go to that site.
Like I'm on that list, so it can't be, too
that.
Terrible.
Yeah,
it'll
be okay.
Right?
Yvette. Shirley is such a nice person most of the time, and sometimes she just snaps. Do you ever foresee that like lasting a whole episode or a whole story arc or something? Or is she just gonna always be nice?
Hi, everybody.
Emotional because I'm kind of sappy, but like Allison said, this is amazing. We have never seen this much humanity in one place celebrating our show, and we are just honored and grateful that you guys are here. Thank you so much. So much. As for Shirley,
pandering going on.
No,
I
mean, you know this is real. Stop playing. See, that was too soft. You see, the sweetness went right to the edge. He's gonna be nice before this is over. like to show her feelings. So it only kind of seeps out when she least expects it, when she's been disrespected or, you know, something has jumped out of her. So will there be an episode where she gets to be completely hateful the whole time?
Does everybody know this is vodka and it's hers?
Wait a minute, before we go further. You're going to hear something on the DVD about me being a lush. And I would like to clarify that I do not drink. This is water. I want to sit here because he's going to keep dropping the drunk stuff. And since you guys are all here and you guys love the show, I want to let you know that I don't drink.
Oh, yeah.
I agree with you. I drink. That's less funny to me because it's so true. That's why I do the event, because she actually doesn't drink. Chevy's, we were really scared for him. He was wandering through the streets of San Diego like Frankenstein's monster. His wife was calling to him, and he was answering a piece of corporate art, thought it was her. What am I doing? What's going on? Where are we? He wandered into the Maxim party, and there were screams, and police showed up, and I ran home.
Do you remember that? Do you remember you punching Seth Rogen in the face? You did that?
Whoa.
Excuse me, I didn't mean to use that word.
There wasn't, we're just calling you drunk. That's not. There was no question. If there was one, it was a rhetorical one. For the love of God, when will it stop? There's no answer. It's a plea.
I'm
addendum to Allison and Yvette. I cried.
She cried.
When we came out here and you guys cheered at first, so if my makeup is smeared, it's because I cried tears of joy at your applause for us. So thank you. I think this little anecdote says it all. I got a call from a friend of mine who's an actress who said, I just read this script and it's you and you have to audition for it. And I was shooting a movie in the middle of nowhere in the woods and I said, I can't. I can't put myself on tape. I can't audition. She said, well, okay, but the part's you. And several months later, I called her and said, I got this part. I'm going to do this pilot. She said, which one? I said, Community. She goes, that's the one I was talking about. Yeah. That was you. So, I think that I recognized it, thankfully Dan Harmon recognized it, and my friend Lindsay recognized it, that that I have a kinship with Britta, and I recognize her desire to be a good person, and that sometimes her intentions go awry, and she ends up causing more harm than good, and I hope that I'm not humorless and a buzzkill. I've never been told that in my real life, but maybe people are saying it behind my back. I was not very popular in high school, so maybe that.
But never went to high school.
Dan was very popular.
But I really love Britta, and I know that, you know, sometimes people think she's a little too harsh, or, you know, she got off on telling Jeff Winger that he was wrong a lot, but she's trying to be a good person and often failing, but the attempt endears her to me.
Tom. Keep some for yourself.
Oh, well, they're much funnier than I am. Well, I don't even see it as that at all. I don't think there's ever been a truer ensemble on television. Maybe there has, but I don't know. I was homeschooled, haven't I? No, but I really think that it is a true ensemble, and I feel like there's, you know, even though some, I don't even know what the hell I'm talking about, but that, you know, the stories are pretty much equal in my mind, and I think everyone else's, but, and it is, like, I believe it's the strong, I mean, if I do say so myself, it's the strongest cast ever, and these are some of the funniest people alive, and there are times though when I get to Troy and Abed get to go ape shit and do crazy stuff, then I become like, oh, I wish I could do that. And then I lost my mind in the pottery episode, so I had to thank Dan for that. I just feel like, you know, it's the strongest, most ensemble that there is. I'm just gonna keep saying it over and over until I stop talking. And I'm gonna interrupt myself with my cup.
And between this and another show you work on called The Soup. Woo! When do you ever sleep?
I sleep during my stand-up gigs. That really helps. I don't sleep a lot, and I don't see my family a lot. It's great. I want to have as many jobs as Seacrest, and I'm not even close at this point.
Danny, and then this also is kind of for the producers, you are very pop cultural savvy, your character is on the show. Do you always know what everything Abed is talking about means, or do you just kind of go with it? Oh. That's for you, Danny. Yes. Sorry.
I don't, actually. Thankfully, I work with this cast who is way more pop culture savvy than I am, so I'll get these scripts and I'll be like, okay, don't know this reference, but I'm going to commit to it. Okay, Meatballs, never heard of it. Netflix, cue it up. It's pretty much like that.
What about that speech in the first episode?
Oh, The Breakfast Club? That one I was pretty familiar with. That was great. That was for fun.
So what about the speech in this upcoming episode?
Goodness. Yeah, there's one coming up.
That is epic.
It's kind of
it's actually like a beautiful poem. Like, oh,
it is.
Every movie represented.
It's sort of a
they want you to do Don Draper from.
Can we do that?
Where am I? I don't sleep. I blink. Where's Tom Flurry?
I don't even know. I was just making stuff up. I'm given such a gift here, and like everyone else, I'm going to echo it. I am the luckiest person on the planet to be doing this role, because to have a voice like this kind of character, this kind of person, you just don't see that very often, you know? Growing up, I never had like a lot of characters like that really kind of struggled connecting with people and didn't really know how to, but they found their place, and that's the best thing about this job, is that each one of us has faults. But we all come together as an ensemble, and everyone accepts each other for what they're doing, you know? And one episode, we're doing Troy and Abed in the morning, and we convinced Jeff to come into the study room at 6 in the morning for a fake morning talk show. Where else can you get away with this shit? It's like, it is seriously like the dream job. And
and
it's all starts with the writing of Dan Harmon, so I'm just very thankful for that.
Because God knows they don't respect me!
First of all, I want to say welcome to Comic-Con.
Thank you!
So this question is for Dom Glover and Andy in particular. With all the comedians on the show, there's probably a lot of improv. How much of that actually makes it onto an episode?
I'll take that.
Same improv.
A lot of it is...
First thing I understood today.
The scripts are very tightly written, and they're very, and we do everything that is in the script, because the writers are brilliant, Dan is brilliant, and they're written so well. And then sometimes there will be, little actions that are different sometimes are just great. Like there's an episode where Allison, You know that part where it's like, well, this gravy train's leaving the station. That was all improv. The line was written, but she added all that weird ending. And my line of don't ignore her, we're serious, was improv. And improv in the sense of like, I was literally like, ignore what she's doing.
Like, this is not going to be in the final cut.
But it's some of that stuff makes it, but in general, our brilliant writers would do everything.
Well, how about in this hang where they play Ernie and Bird? And then, at the end, Donald improvised the line, oh, I'm late for my cousin's funeral.
That was actually about Nicole Brown's idea. The Bert and Ernie.
I think they look like Bert and Ernie. Thanks, Cootie.
From the mouths of drunks, great ideas. I knew you were sitting there. I never think that it's my idea. It was circus. That's idea. I almost got a shilling.
Thanks, Harlan.
This question is for Allison, the Maxim model. Yes. Allison, I saw you co-host Attack of the Show, and you were amazing on there. And I just had a question. If you weren't doing Community, what would you be doing? Like the modeling or a show like The Soup with Joel? Like co-host The Soup with Joel?
Modeling or what would it be?
Well, yes, and I, you know, for a long time I've been considering pursuing a modeling career. The height thing is a problem. No, I'm joking. I'm so flattered that you wouldn't have asked that.
Oh, no problem.
Because no, I've never thought about anything like that. I think if I were to, I mean, you know, I have a side gig on Mad Men. When not doing Community, I tend to do that and then just try to dabble in whatever's available. Podcasts, horror movies. If I'm available. Modeling. But thank you, gosh.
You're welcome.
Next question.